Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, we're going to look at alkyne reduction or hydrogenation, where we reduce an alkyne to an alkane, a cis alkene, or trans alkene. Recall from general chemistry that reduction means gain of electrons. We're going to translate this to the gain of hydrogen atoms, which also happens to include the electrons. Since an alkyne has two pi bonds, we have the potential to reduce both of them, meaning break the pi bond and add hydrogen atoms. An alkyne can be reduced three different ways. The first is a standard catalytic reduction using H2 gas and some metal like platinum, palladium, or nickel. This reaction will attack both pi bonds, giving us two sets of hydrogen atoms being added. We'll show one added for the first pi bond that we break, and a second set of hydrogen for the second pi bond that we break. This is the most that we can reduce an alkyne, because we only had two pi bonds. But if we go with a partial reduction and only attack one pi bond, we have the option of forming a cis alkene or forming a trans alkene. The cis reduction happens in the presence of a poison metal catalyst. The most common one you'll see is the Lindlar's catalyst, so you'll write it as H2 with Lindlar's. This will break just one pi bond and add two hydrogen atoms syn to each other on the same face of the molecule, putting the two R groups syn to each other on the other face of the molecule for a cis product. And finally, we have the dissolving metal reduction, which is dissolving a group 1 metal like sodium or lithium in a solution like liquid ammonia. This reaction will break one pi bond and give us two hydrogen atoms that add anti or opposite from each other, pushing the R groups anti or opposite from each other for a trans product. Let's go into each reaction in more detail. Catalytic reduction of alkynes is very similar to what you saw from alkenes. Recall from alkene reactions that catalytic reduction takes an H2 gas and puts it onto the pi bond and breaks the pi bond, adding to the same face of the molecule. The mechanism isn't fully understood, but we have some idea as to what's going on. Imagine that you have a metal catalyst that is holding hydrogen atoms. This is because the H2 gas already broke apart and was grabbed by the metal and is just sitting on the surface of the metal. Now imagine that the metal is going to reach for the carbon atoms, and when it does so, it breaks that pi bond between them. This is why the reaction is a syn addition, because the metal grabbing the carbon reaches for both carbons at the same time from the same position, and then the hydrogen atoms that are also sitting on the metal will simply slide over and attach onto the carbon atoms. They're adding from the same face of the molecule. This would happen to both faces of the pi bond, so that your ultimate product is a carbon chain with just a sigma bond between the two carbons, and then two sets of hydrogen atoms having added together at the same face. So we'll show green for the first pi bond that we broke, and blue for the second. This is a fully reduced alkane. When you write out this reaction, you have to specify or assume that it's H2 in excess, because to reduce an alkyne with two pi bonds, we're adding two sets of hydrogen atoms. You'll see it shown with the word excess, just the letters XS, or even 2 molar or 2 equivalents to show that we're adding 2 moles. But don't think that 2 moles means if I decide to only put 1 mole, then we'll only have one pi bond broken. That's not the case. Because imagine a situation where you start with 3 alkynes and you're thinking, if I only use 3 moles of H2 gas, then each alkyne will have 1 H2 added and I will get an alkene product. That is not the case because it's not easy to control and the product will be random. The green one might get 0 reduction, giving you an alkyne as your final product. The blue one might get a double reduction, giving you an alkane as your final product. And the purple one might go halfway, giving you an alkene product. This is not all alkene, it's nothing, complete, and partial. Definitely not effective to get a product. So what do you do if you want a catalytic reduction that stops at the alkene? question is, do you want cis or trans? In order to get a cis alkene, we have to use a poison metal catalyst. A poison metal catalyst still uses H2 gas. That means we're still adding the hydrogen, but being that the catalyst is poison, it's a little slower, it's a little effective, and it's only capable of adding 1 rather than 2 moles of H2. Imagine that the metal, as sluggish as it is, works the same way. It grabs the carbon from the same face and adds the 2 hydrogen atoms to the same face. Showing this with 1 pi bond still intact, and the 2 hydrogen atoms having added to the same face, the 2 R groups get pushed down, get pushed away for a cis product. The most common poison metal catalyst that you're going to see in organic chemistry is the Lindlar's catalyst, and I like to think of it as the lazy catalyst. It's so lazy, it does half a job, and then it quits. Most of you will only have to recognize Lindlar's without the details, but in case your professor asks, the Lindlar's catalyst is a monstrosity that looks like this. Quinoline, palladium, dissolved with barium sulfate in a methanol solution. Or we could just say Lindlar's, much easier. Don't memorize Lindlar's cis. Understand why. So the key why in this reaction is that a metal grabs from the same face, the hydrogens get added syn to each other, and that gives us a cis product. This is opposite of the dissolving metal reduction, where the key intermediate that determines the why is a radical. And that radical intermediate will force a trans final product. This reaction happens because we're using a group 1 element, which in its neutral state has just 1 valence electron. For example, sodium or lithium. This is dissolved in a cold solution. Ammonia at room temperature is not liquid, but if it's really cold, it will be liquid, with a radical intermediate. Let's take a look at the mechanism so you understand exactly why it goes trans. This mechanism starts out with a sodium in solution. Even though it's neutral, it should be happy. It's not. It has that 1 unpaired valence electron, making it very unhappy. And it doesn't want the electron, so it gives it away. And it gives that electron to the carbon atom. Notice we're showing the mechanism with a single-headed or fishhook arrow to represent the movement of 1 rather than 2 electrons, making this a radical mechanism. I also want you to follow the colors of every electron as we move along so you understand exactly where things are moving and why they're doing what they do. We'll show the pi bond as 2 red electrons breaking apart. When carbon gets that 1 green electron from sodium, that electron does not want to be by itself. So 1 electron from the pi bond with a fishhook arrow showing that just 1 electron moves over to meet that green electron and form a lone pair. The other electron gets kicked away. It's a third wheel, there's nothing for it, and so it breaks away onto that second carbon. Our intermediate looks something like this. On the right, we have a green and a red electron with a lone pair and therefore a negative charge. On the left, we have a neutral radical. This right here is where we determine that the product will ultimately be trans. Soon as we go from the triple bond, which is linear, to the double bond, the angle changes. We have 2 options. On the left, we'll show the lone pair of electrons, cis to the radical. On the right, we'll show the lone pair of electrons, trans to the radical. Don't forget, these electrons have their personal space, and the Vesper theory, valence shell electron pair repulsion, tells us that they don't like being next to each other. When we have this cis intermediate, the 2 electron clouds are too close together. Electrons near electrons makes them very unhappy, very unstable, and therefore not likely to form. On the right, we have the 2 electron clouds as far away from each other as possible. Having the lone pair of electrons facing completely anti, completely away from that radical, they're as far away from each other as possible, making this the absolute most stable intermediate. And since the molecule had to adopt a trans configuration, the ultimate product will also be a trans configuration because of this intermediate right here. But we have too many electrons going on, and this is very unhappy. Remember, this reaction takes place in NH3 liquid, which means we have ammonia floating around everywhere. Ammonia is a polar protic solvent with a partially negative nitrogen atom and a partially positive hydrogen. That partially positive hydrogen will attract the lone electron pair, the one that's made from the green or red electrons. These electrons will reach out for one of the hydrogen atoms, breaking the bond between hydrogen and nitrogen to collapse those electrons back onto the nitrogen atom. The green and the red electron are still attached to the molecule, but now they're sitting as a bond between carbon and the purple hydrogen we grabbed from ammonia. We also have an NH2 remaining in solution, with a lone pair of electrons from the initial nitrogen, and a second lone pair from the bond between hydrogen and nitrogen that collapsed, giving this a negative charge. Well, guess what? That sodium, when it donated its electron, gave us an Na+, and this is now a positive-negative ion. This gives us a balanced salt somewhere in solution that we don't really care about. What we do care about is the fact that we still have a radical, and that is not stable. Lucky for this molecule, there is another unhappy sodium floating around in solution. It is unhappy because despite being neutral, it has that one unpaired electron and it wants to get rid of it. It gives that electron to the carbon that already has one red electron, the one radical, allowing sodium to get rid of that electron, forming an Na+ that dissolves in solution, and a second lone electron sitting on the left carbon atom. This gives carbon on the left a lone pair, negative charge. But carbon is not quite satisfied because a negative charge on carbon, still no good. So it reaches out for hydrogen on another ammonia floating around in solution, breaking the bond between hydrogen and nitrogen, collapsing those electrons onto nitrogen. And this gives us our final product. We have the red electron and blue electron, once a lone pair, now sitting as a single bond between carbon and the hydrogen that we grabbed from ammonia. The rest of the ammonia molecule is now NH2- floating around in solution, able to pair up with the sodium that we created from that second radical step. But these are just spectators. What we care about is the fact that we formed a neutral trans alkene. Be sure to join me in the next video, where we look at the mechanism for the hydrohalogenation of alkynes. You can find that video, along with the entire alkyne video series, practice quiz, and cheat sheet by visiting my website, leahforsci.com/alkyne.